Be seated. Let me invite you to take your copy of God's Word and turn to Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9. We finished a series just last week. We will do a four-part series this month. And then in January, I intend to resume our ongoing longer series through the Gospel according to John. If you just recently tuning in with us, we last December, 1st of December, we began the Gospel of John, and we made it up through the end of chapter 8 by, I guess it was the 1st of October. And so we'll resume in chapter 9 of the Gospel of John in January. Throughout our Advent season, I want us to look at Isaiah chapter 9 and really one verse. One verse is what I want us to focus our attention on. And then we are, in understanding that one verse, we are going to go, we're going to see the greater context that that verse falls in. We'll look at that heavily today and next Sunday. And then we'll also be flipping to the New Testament some to see the fulfillment of this one verse in the person and work of Christ. So let's just begin our reading this morning in Isaiah chapter 9, and I'm going to read the one verse, and then we're going to back up from there. So Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, you are likely familiar with this verse. The Bible says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." I intend over the next four Sundays to expound upon those four names, those four titles that are given to the coming Messiah in Isaiah's prophecy. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Let's begin this morning with the idea of examining Wonderful Counselor. Jesus is the fulfillment of this verse. If you did not know that when I read that, he's the child that's being referred to. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. His name shall be called, and then you have these four names. That's Jesus. Isaiah is pointing us to Christ. He's pointing us to the first advent of Christ. Advent simply means arrival, coming, and it provokes anticipation when you're waiting on somebody to come. You are excited about the arrival of this person that is coming. This is essentially a birth announcement. This is a very similar to what you see on Facebook today. Somebody will post a little sonogram photo that shows their little peanut. I mean, literally kind of what it looks like when you first time you see it. And you're looking at that in the black and the white picture, and you're like, what is that? That's what this is. This is the birth announcement, except this is a royal birth announcement. So this is the announcement of the birth of a king that is coming with titles like Wonderful Counselor and Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. This verse begins with the word for. This is a explanatory word. This is a word that means that this verse is an explanation of stuff that has come before it, stuff that has come before it. This verse is an explanation of previous verses. And so when we see it, we want to back up just a little bit. So I'm going to back us up to verse 2, Isaiah 9, verse 2. Now, before I read it, I want to point something out to you. depending on your translation, it likely looks a little bit different in verses 2 through 5 than it does in verse 1. The layout does. If you're looking at, you can't see this on the screen, but if you're looking at the Bible, which I would always encourage you to do, hold open it, read it. If you're looking at it, it's likely written a little bit differently. There's some different indentions. Does anybody have that? Looking at it, there's a few hands. Okay. The indentions are different. Verse 1, the indentions are kind of out to the margins, and it's like block form. And then verses 2 through 7, it begins, it's indented, and certain lines are indented more than other lines. Y'all see that? Amen? Okay. That is a signal from the publisher that this is poetry at this point. So before that, we have more narration, and now we come into Hebrew poetry. How Isaiah's prophecy would have been recorded, how it was written, was very poetic in its writing. So anytime you see those indentions like that, you see that a lot in the Psalms and the Proverbs at various places, it simply means it's Hebrew poetry. It's written with a poetic flow to it. And of course, oftentimes we don't hear that in the English. We don't hear the rhyming words and things like that. But in the Hebrew, that's how that would have been written. So this is, in fact, a big birth announcement, even to the point that it is written in a certain way. Again, I take you back to us announcing our pregnancies and our births that when they come in our society. We still do this in a similar fashion. Isaiah is calling attention to this birth announcement that is coming. So to understand verse 6, let's go back to verse 2 and read down through verse 5. The Bible says, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light." Now, I want you to focus. I want you to hear the good news in this birth announcement. "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire." This is good things that are coming, Isaiah is saying, to this people. This people who has suffered under a yoke of burden. These people who has experienced bondage. He is telling them good news is down the road. There is coming hope. There's coming a Messiah. And then he explains the good news in verse 6 by saying, "A child is born." This is the answer. This is the solution to all of our woes. There is a son that is given. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. So we see this birth announcement of good news. But I've said many times that good news isn't all that good unless you understand the bad news. Good news is simply news if there is no bad news to contrast with the good. And so we're going to keep backing up through Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1. "But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time," now we're starting to see what was happening. "In the former time beforehand, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations." And then we enter into the Hebrew poetry of a birth announcement. I want you to notice two words in chapter 9, verse 1. Those words are gloom and glory. Gloom and glory. "But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish." And then later, "But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea." I've entitled this 4-week series, "From Gloom to Glory." From gloom to glory. We could simply say from bad news to good news. From despair to hope, from darkness to light. But to use Isaiah's words, we're going to use from gloom to glory, the coming of the Savior. I want you to notice in chapter 9, verse 1, the very first word, but. Again, every English teacher in here, every grammarian in here is cringing at the fact that he would start not only a new sentence, but a new chapter with this conjunction, but. That tells us that this is an ongoing thought. This is not a new thought. This is a point of contrast and comparison. This is changing ideas a little bit. So, truthfully, and I'm not going to do this, so don't worry. Truthfully, we really ought to read all the way up to chapter 9 in the book to understand this, but. So my eyes just got really big. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to read 8 chapters with you this morning. Relax. Really, we should read all of chapter 8. I'm not going to do that either. It's only 22 verses, but I'm not going to do that either. I think you can get the picture if I simply back up to verse 16 of chapter 8. Just a handful of verses. But I want you to, listen, in order to understand Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, you got to know the context. In preaching, we have a saying, and simply, context is king. Context is king. Context sets the boundaries and the understanding of our interpretation. I mean, you could hear Wonderful Counselor and think Guidance Counselor in high school. Well, that's not what he's taught. That's not what Jesus come to do. And we'll come back to that analogy in a moment. But that's not what Jesus came to do. So we don't read it in our own context. We read it into Isaiah's context that he gives us. So read with me. Isaiah chapter 8, beginning in verse 16. Bind up the testimony, seal the teaching among the disciples. Isaiah says, I will wait for the Lord who is hiding his face from the house of Jacob, and I will hope in him. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord has given me are signs and portents in Israel from the Lord of hosts who dwell on Mount Zion. Now hear this part, verse 19. When they say to you, inquire of the mediums and the necromancers who chirp and mutter. Should not a people inquire of their God? Should they inquire of the dead on behalf of the living? To the teaching and to the testimony. If they will not speak according to this word, it is because they have no dawn. They will pass through the land greatly distressed and hungry. And when they are hungry, they will be enraged and will speak contemptuously against their king and their God. And they will turn their faces upward. And hear this point of horrific despair and sadness in verse 22. And they will look to the earth, but behold, distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish. And they will be thrust into thick darkness. But there will be no gloom, Isaiah says, for her who was in anguish. He has made a way glorious. And then we get into this description of this child that is going to be born. Do you see how the bad news makes the good news oh so much sweeter? So let's spend just a moment talking about this bad news. I want you to notice in verse 17 that this bad news is because God has done something. The bad news is because God has done something. Now, God has done something as a response to the people's sin. But notice Isaiah's words in verse 17. I will wait for the Lord. Who is doing what? Who is hiding his face from the house of Jacob? The gloom, the darkness, that all comes when God hides his face. This explains the darkness. If God is light, then the absence of God is the absence of light. And the absence of light is called darkness. God is, in fact, light. The gospel, according to John chapter 1, verse 4, John 1, verse 4, the Bible says of Jesus, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In 1 John, the epistle at the end of the New Testament, John's letter, first letter, in chapter 1, verse 5, he says, this is the message that we have heard from him, and we proclaim to you. Here's the message. Here's the message of John the Apostle. This is summed up in one word, one little phrase. This is John's message, that God is light, and in him, in God, is no darkness at all. But what happens when God hides his face? Darkness happens. That's the land that Isaiah writes in. That's the context. When God hides his face, there is total darkness. There is specifically total spiritual darkness. This is, of course, figurative language most of the time. At the cross, it became very literal and very physical when total darkness came across the land for those latter 3 hours of the crucifixion of Christ. The Israelites knew what darkness was. They knew physical, literal darkness when they were in the land of Goshen in Egypt in the book of Exodus. And in the plagues, darkness came across the land for 3 days. Of course, Israel being in Goshen, God kept the lights on. What happened? I think God hid his face. I think the people saw a physical understanding of very spiritual language. When God hides his face, there is total spiritual darkness. So what does this darkness look like? Look at verse 21, Isaiah chapter 8, verse 21. Isaiah says, they will pass through the land, greatly distressed and hungry. When they are hungry, they will be enraged. You know what that is right there? Hangry. That's hangry. Y'all know the word hangry, right? That's hangry right there. Snickers is not the people that came up with that. God came up with that. Greatly distressed and hungry. And when they are hungry, they will be enraged. That's hangry. And will speak contemptuously against their king and their God. Imagine people speaking against their God. Again, I take you back. I take you back to the 40 years wandering in the wilderness. After God has rescued them and delivered them out of Egypt. And they complain. God, have you just brought us out here to die, to starve to death? Okay, well, I'll give you some quail and I'll give you some manna fresh every morning. So their buffet eventually became where it wasn't as pleasing, and they began to complain about that. Oh, Israel was such a complaining people, often speaking contemptuously against their king and their God, turning their faces upward at him. Spiritual darkness is this aimlessness. It is blind wandering, not really finding what you're looking for. If we go back even further in Isaiah 8, we see such despair and hopelessness. We see that it is the immediate result of their sin. But this is not just Israel. This is the human condition. This is mankind's state. To live in despair and hopelessness as a result of sin. This is the effects of Genesis chapter 3. This is the world that you and I live in. We live in a world of darkness and despair and hopelessness so often. Notice that Isaiah prophesies that the people of Israel will do exactly what you and I really do. In other words, they look everywhere. Look at verses 19 down through 22. When they say to you, inquire of the mediums and the necromancers who chirp and mutter. And Isaiah says, should not a people inquire of their God? I mean, isn't that a logical conclusion? Shouldn't we ask God? But no, we're asking the necromancers and the mediums. What's he talking about? What are these words? These are people that try to call up dead spirits to seek advice and counsel from. I know this sounds really, really bizarre. I know that we can't really imagine anything quite of this caliber, but I assure you it happens. I assure you, you can drive down the road and you can see signs with people willing to read your fortune or tell you your future for a small fee, of course. As believers, we can simply tell them the gospel of Jesus and not charge them a dime. People turn everywhere but to the Lord. They have folks that are going to call on the spirit world somehow and serve as a mediator in a conversation between either the spirits or sometimes dead folks in a hope to somehow find something, some good news to cling to for a little while until once again they have to go back to that medium. Just imagine this, but truthfully we don't have to imagine very hard, do we? We really don't. This is very popular. In fact, last week, the New York Times ran an article about a lady that lives in the Elfin Forest. Just going to leave that there for a second and let that sink in. Carissa Schumacher, 39 years old, just outside of Los Angeles, California. And her job, her calling, as she calls it, is to channel the dead. And she does this not just for folks like you and I, but really for A-list celebrities. The reason this was in an article is last Saturday, a week ago, they had an event. And the likes of Jennifer Aniston and Uma Thurman and Andy McDowell from my own back door in Asheville attended this big event because Ms. Schumacher is not just channeling the dead. She specifically channels, or claims to, in her sense, Yeshua. How many of you know who Yeshua is? Anybody know who Yeshua is? That is the Old Testament, that is the Hebrew for Jesus. She claims to channel Jesus, but in a spirit of reverence and holiness, won't call him Jesus. Calls him of the Old Testament name Yeshua. I would say in a spirit of phoniness and nonsense. Ms. Schumacher in the article shares her testimony with the New York Times, and this is the article. It says, quote, after leaving the company, some big business that she worked for and experienced some sort of harassment and some sort of traumatic event in her life, she left the company. She moved to the Elfin Forest just outside of Los Angeles. And one day, she said, she returned home from a hike in the forest, and she felt a blue flame swirl down her spine. I don't know how you feel the color blue, but she did. She felt a blue flame swirl down her spine. She heard glass shatter and a baby cry. She said this is when she first felt Yeshua's energy. She then consulted her, and I'm going to try to pronounce this correctly, nature doctor. That's what it is, nature doctor. Naturopathic doctor. And from there, the article continues to spiral into more and more nonsense. I heard this story in the early part of this week, and I was reading Isaiah 8, and I'm like, when did Isaiah write this? He wrote it thousands of years ago. And he is speaking of exactly the culture that you and I live in today. That this is not far off stuff. People are still calling on the dead. They're still going to spirits for hope. They look to the earth, Isaiah 8:22. But behold, distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish. Listen, Christmas is the most joyous time of the year in my home. I love it. It takes me a minute. I'm not with some of y'all. It took me a minute. I had to eat my turkey first on Thanksgiving before I could experience Christmas. Okay? Now, I know some of y'all have been joy celebrating since like October 1. I'm not there. I'm a day after Thanksgiving kind of guy. I'm ordered. Miss Yvette reminds me often that men are like waffles. We have little compartments in our brains, and we pour our syrup in our little compartments. Listen, I had my Halloween compartment and then my Thanksgiving compartment, but now I'm into my little Christmas compartment, okay? And I'm there, and it's joyous, and there's music, and there's popcorn, and there's cranberry. We have more food on our tree than decorations anyway. We got all this stuff just hanging on the tree, and there's gifts, and there's lights, and just all the festivities. I love it. It is a joyous time. But please understand that for so many in the world, it is a time of commercialization and not joy. It is a time of man-made fun. And most of the things that I just described to you are man-made fun and joy. But as believers, we understand that there is more to the story. It's not the commercialization. It's the baby. It's the birth announcement that we're celebrating. Imagine what we're doing. Just think about this for a moment. Many of you that have had children like me and my wife I think our kids now are called Generation Alpha. I can't give you the dates for that, but my kids fall into that category. It's the social media. Like, they're born into a land not knowing anything but social media, not knowing what a landline is. I remember the first time my kids saw my big office, my big desk phone on my office, and they asked me what that was. I'm not exaggerating one bit, did not know what that was. Many of y'all have had kids in that generation, right? And we all do these big reveals and these big parties and these big posts, you know, on social media about our pregnancies and our births and all this stuff. And great for all that stuff, but just imagine going back every year and celebrating that. Just imagine every year you show again that ultrasound picture, that little black and white peanut. Every single year, just you don't really celebrate. You know, you're not doing birthday cake for the 4-year-old, the 5-year-old, the 6-year-old. You're just going back and saying, "I remember when we heard about you." That's what we're doing at Christmas. We're coming back to the birth announcement over and over again. Because there was so much hope given with this announcement. The people that lived in darkness and despair, that are thrust into a thick darkness, Isaiah says. But then Isaiah says in chapter 9, verse 1, but, and again, I still think that's the best word in all of the Bible, but there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, the Galilee of the nations. Chapter 9, verse 2, the people who walked in darkness have now seen a great light. What good news. Those who dwelt in the land, who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them the light has shone. Yes, we move from the darkness of despair to the hope of light. Oh, I love light. I love it. If I walk into a room, my wife will testify, if I walk into a room and there's not a light on, I will turn a light on. I'm not saying if there's not any light on. I'm saying if there was one light that was not left on, that was intentionally left off, I will turn that light on. I want every light in the room on because I like light. Sometimes early in the morning, you know, she's in the kitchen and we just got the one little light, kind of a night light. She can cook by that. She can read by that. She can make coffee by that. She can have a full-blown breakfast by this one little light that's left on overnight in the kitchen. But when I walk in, I turn the big lights on because I want to see things in light. I love light. I hate darkness. I am nearing the end of my fourth decade of life. I'm nearing the end. And I'm telling you something, I am still fearful of the dark. And I'm not ashamed to tell you that. I'm not embarrassed. I don't like being in the dark. I can do it. I can go out in the dark, but I know what's in the dark. I know what hides in the dark. I know the kind of critters that are in the dark. Whether we're talking about my backyard critters or we're talking about downtown late at night critters. I know the kind of critters that hide out in the dark. I don't like darkness. I want to shine a light on that just as quickly as I possibly can. The people who walked in darkness have now seen a great light, Isaiah says. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them the light has shone. We've seen the gloom, now let us see the glory. It's a game changer when the light is flipped on. The critters run, they flee, they hide from the light. How does this light come on, you ask? Isaiah explains it to us in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born. That's how the light is turned on. Unto us a son is given. That's how the light is turned on. The words wonderful counselor. And maybe your translation has a comma between those two words. Scholars have debated whether this is two different titles or one title. One noun with an adjective. I tend to think it's a noun with an adjective. Some think it's two different nouns. He's wonderful and he's a counselor. Two different titles. Either way. The point remains basically the same. The word counselor in the Hebrew is defined as advice or God's plan. Don't think about this as a therapeutic counselor, but think more in the mindset of your high school guidance counselor, as by way of analogy. Do you remember those meetings in high school with the guidance counselor, anybody? I hated those meetings. I really needed a guidance counselor, not in high school. I needed a guidance counselor in my first year of college, and then my second year of college, and then my third year, fourth year, and fifth year at my community college. That's when I really needed a guidance counselor. I needed guidance, big time. I spent 5 years working on a two-year degree. I needed guidance. Lots of it. Because I tried every career path they present. So, yeah, that sounds great. I could see me doing that. I tried that. I needed guidance. But the point of that counselor in high school was to help set you on the right path towards college, towards career, the right training, the right classes to set you up for what's coming down the road. Now, the Messiah is the great counselor, offering advice concerning the spiritual path that you should take, not towards your career, but towards eternity. And this is what it means to shine the light. See, when I turn a flashlight on, I don't point the flashlight around me. Where do I point the flashlight at? Where I'm headed. Try teaching that to a child. They're carrying the flashlight and it's just looking everywhere. No, I need it right in front of me to see what's on the path. I want to see the critters before I step on them. Like I want to avoid any objects that are in my way going down that path. And so the light lights the path for me. And likewise, Christ is that counselor, illuminating the path ahead of me where I ought to go. This is what it means to shine the light. This is what a flashlight does. This is what the headlights on your car do. I mean, wouldn't it be weird if you had headlights on the doors and they like point out to the sides? That'd just be dumb, wouldn't it? No, we want headlights on the front of the car because this is where we're going. It illuminates the path. Lights, in fact, only illuminate the path that they shine on. If my headlights are pointed this way, it doesn't really light up anything behind me. It's lighting up what's ahead of me. It's illuminating the path. The word's wonderful in this text is the idea of full of wonder. And it's not just wonderful. That's nice. That's not what he's saying. That's sweet. That's wonderful. That's not it. It's the idea of full of wonder or full of awe. It is to stand and to gaze upon in amazement. In other words, this is the miraculous or the supernatural. He's the wonderful. He's the counselor that works wonders. He's the counselor that works in miraculous and supernatural ways. Again, we ask the question, how? How is Jesus the wonderful counselor? Quickly, allow me to suggest three ways that Christ is the wonderful counselor. Number one is the incarnation of Christ. The incarnation of Christ. Jesus came in the flesh to show the way. That's what this means. God become flesh. That's the word incarnation. God becomes flesh. He takes on human flesh in order to illuminate the way. This is exactly what Jesus said to Thomas just before his crucifixion. When Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I leave, I'll come back and take you to where I am. And then Thomas says, but Jesus, how do we know where you're going? We don't know where you're going, and if we don't know where you're going, how in the world can we know the way? And then Jesus quotes that famous verse of exclusivity in Christ, and he says, I am the way. I am the way. I'm the light. I'm the counselor. I'm getting you where you're going. You go with me. You don't get there outside of me, Jesus says. No man comes to the Father but by me. Not only is Jesus the incarnation, not only is Jesus the wonderful counselor in the miracle and the supernatural work of the incarnation, but he's the wonderful counselor in the word of Christ. Jesus spoke. He didn't just come and work, he spoke. He said things. And then people, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, people like John and Matthew and Mark and Luke recorded what he spoke. They wrote it down. And you and I hold it in our hands today and treat it extremely flippantly and trivial. We almost treat it like it's a burden because it's too heavy to carry from the car to the pew. We literally have the words of Jesus here. And half the time we don't even care. But see the wonder. See the wonder that Jesus has given you his word. I mean, see the wonder that you got Jesus' word right here. If that doesn't amaze you, I don't know what it's going to take for you. If you can't get over the fact that, or can't deal with this reality, that the creator of the heavens and the earth has spoken, and you carry his written words in your pocket and can access them at any point you want to. That is mind-blowing to me. That is utterly mind-blowing. There's a meme that went around a while ago, a couple of years ago, of a guy sitting at a table, his breakfast table, and he's praying, God, show me your will. God, tell me what you want me to do with my life. And he's sitting there praying and he's agonizing over, what is it? In other words, he's asking, when you ask that question, by the way, God, what is your will? You're simply asking, illuminate the path for me. Shine light where I need to go. The man's sitting there praying this, and all the while, there sits a book across the table closed like this. Do you see the point of that? Don't pray, God, show me your will, with a closed Bible. That's silly. That is utterly silly. That is like me going and asking my wife, honey, what do I need? What's on the honey-do list for this weekend? And then going, la, 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 I can't hear you. I guess it's that silly. It is that silly. Me saying, hey, asking a question and looking for an answer and then totally tuning her out. That's silly. But that's what we do when we pray to God with our Bibles closed. And we ask God to speak into our lives and our hearts. Ask him to show us the way. Ask him what his will for us is with a closed Bible. That is silly. The God of the heavens and the earth has spoken, and we have it. Matthew chapter 4, verse 4, Jesus answers and says, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. Some of y'all making New Year's resolutions, diet, right? Some of these, I ain't looking at nobody in particular. I'm just saying, like some of y'all having this conversation right now and you're looking at diets. Jesus speaks into that. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. You want a diet or a resolution this year, look to that one. In Psalm chapter 119, verse 105, our VBS kids say this every year. And we call it the Pledge of the Bible, but all they're doing is really quoting Psalm 119 when they say this. They say, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Turn the light on, folks. Open the word of Christ. Finally, the third way that I want to suggest that Christ is the wonderful counselor is really the third person of the Trinity, and that's the Spirit of God. John chapter 14. Just after Jesus tells Thomas that he's taken off and he's going to go prepare a place, Thomas says, yeah, but how are we going to know how to get there? And he says, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Just a few verses later, Jesus says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. Some translations call him the Counselor. It's a fitting. The Helper, the Counselor, the Illuminator, the Light Turner Owner, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things, and he will bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. You see the wonder that Jesus leaves, ascends, goes to heaven, and yet sends the Spirit of God. And listen, to go further with that, where does the Spirit of God come? He sets up shop and lives, dwells in your heart and in your life. If that doesn't cause you to wonder, I don't know what will. Perhaps we are so immersed in this nominal Christianity of ours and our culture that we are no longer awestruck by our wonderful Counselor. We don't see the wonder of his counsel, but friends, we should. Think about this birth announcement in Isaiah's prophecy. A child is coming to supernaturally advise you. That's what wonderful Counselor is, to supernaturally, miraculously guide you and illuminate the way for you. I don't want to be too terribly redundant, but the last five Sundays of the great five solas of our faith that we have recently been through, this is it. This is all here predicted in Isaiah chapter 9. Let me say it this way. For God's own glory, by his grace, he sent a child, namely Christ, only Christ. He's the only son that he sent. He sent Christ so that through faith alone and in his son Christ alone, you might know the way to be reconciled to the Father. It is totally miraculous. Your salvation is totally miraculous. There ought to be wonder. Perhaps your home's a little bit different than mine this year, and you're entering into the Christmas season in darkness. You're coming in, the tree lights are on, but the gloom is still there. Let me encourage you that Jesus is the counsel that you need. Whether it's addiction, depression, anxiety, some of you are dealing with sorrow and heartache, some of you are suffering with loneliness, Jesus is the wonderful Counselor that you need. Will you call on him? Trust him today. Trust his counsel. Trust his wonder. God has sent his only son, his only begotten son for you. Would you believe him today? Would you trust him? I promise you, if your Christmas is wrapped up in commercialism or wrapped up in heartache or not wrapped up in the joy of that great birth announcement, let me encourage you to just simply reach out to the Savior today. Forget all that stuff. Forget all the lights, the candles, the trees, the gifts, the songs. Forget all that. And say what we said earlier when we sang, O come, Emmanuel. O come, God with us. Some of you need to simply pray that prayer this morning. God with us, come. Come into my heart. Come into my life. Come into my home this Christmas season. I'm going to ask you to stand, and we're going to pray here in just a moment. If you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, if Christ has never come into your home, into your heart, to your life, what better day is there? Don't wait till tomorrow. Trust him today. Trust him this morning. Maybe you simply need to publicly trust him. I invite you to do that. Others of you just simply need to repent. You can't enjoy the birth of the Savior because you've been trusting so hard in your own ability to fix your own problems, and you just need to say, I can't do it. That addicted child, grandchild, at some point you got to say, I can't fix that, but I know the wonderful counselor that can. That loneliness of another Christmas without your spouse. I can't imagine that. I can't imagine how your heart hurts when you put that tree up and you hang those ornaments. But Christ can. God gave his only son. You don't have to do this alone. You don't have to go through another holiday season in loneliness and heartache and sorrow. The wonderful counselor is there. Would you trust him this morning? If I can pray with you, I'm happy to do that. Father, in the name of Jesus, would you send your son Jesus into our homes this Christmas? God, I pray that we wouldn't mask our gloom with lights and trees and decorations. Pray, God, that you would convict us for faking it so often. And God, would you send your son Christ to turn the lights on, to shine the great light, to illuminate in our hearts and our homes. May our hope be in Jesus this Christmas, I pray. Amen. Let's sing together, and if I can pray with you, I'm certainly happy to do that.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. the mountains, and I believe I'll see you through it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you through it again. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. Is my confidence, you never failed me yet.
Father in heaven, Lord, would you seal that truth in our hearts this morning? God, as we celebrate the first coming, the first advent, as we remember that great birth announcement from the prophet Isaiah, Father, would you seal that truth towards the second advent, towards the second coming of Christ that we anxiously anticipate. And God, I pray that over the next 20 days till Christmas, Lord, and thereafter, God, would we anticipate and be anxious and excited towards the second coming of that Messiah, our Jesus. God, do this, we ask in Christ's name. Amen. Let me, you be seated for a moment, please. You're going to have to bear with me a minute. I know you're anxious and you're starting to think that the other churches in town are going to beat you to the Mexican place. They'll save you a seat. It's okay. I have several announcements. It's just a busy time of the year. I'm going to go ahead and ask for forgiveness now. I'm going to move through some of these quickly. Our men's ministry is meeting this evening at 5:30 at Clint Stevens' home. Several have signed up. I'm really excited about this. If you didn't sign up, it's okay. It's okay. Come anyway. If you're sitting here thinking, I don't know if I really want to, yes, you do. It's great weather. It's not going to be cold tonight. It's going to be just right for a campfire, and we're going to sit around a fire. Clint is making taco soup. You're going to enjoy a bowl of soup around a fire. Bring your kids. Bring your sons. Anyway, bring the boys. And just have a men's night. Really looking forward to that. No big agenda. We're not going to preach to you. We're just going to hang out. We're just going to hang out and have some fun together and get to know each other a little bit better. And I'm really looking forward to that. There's an address there if you need it. I'll text it to you. Clint, wave your hand. Clint's over here in a blue shirt. He will answer any questions you got about it after the service. Our poinsettias, if you want to order a poinsettia, that will be displayed on the front steps here over the next 2 weeks. You can do that. You can do that in memory of somebody, in honor of somebody, if you choose to do that. They're $12 a piece, but you got to do it by today, and you got to do it at the welcome desk. Take care of that before you leave today. Next Sunday evening, our Secret Sister is part of our women's ministry. They've done the Secret Sister deal where they encourage one another and love on each other over the course of all that. Over the course of this year, they reveal those gifts, who the Secret Sister is, next Sunday at 4:30. They're also signing up for another year of Secret Sister. Am I right on that? She's gone. Somebody tell me, am I right on that, Miss Sylvia? You're signing up, you're doing that, and they need to probably call the office to do that. So if you're going to do Secret Sister again next year, you need to let Miss Yvette know in the office. Sunday night, the 19th, that's 2 weeks from today. We don't typically have Sunday evening services, but we're going to that night on our night of worship. We did this last year. Many of y'all came. It was a fantastic night together of simply worship primarily through music. I don't intend to preach. Everybody said amen. So 6:30 on the 19th, our worship team is rehearsing for that, getting ready for that. And they will lead the worship service that evening at 6:30. The following Wednesday, this is the Wednesday before Christmas, on the 22nd. That Wednesday night will be devoted to our children leading us in worship that evening through a drama of the Christmas story. Miss Ruby and Miss Theresa have been working really hard with them. They'll have practice again this afternoon at 2 o'clock, but they and again next Sunday too. But on the Wednesday night, the 22nd, we'll have all of that followed by a brief time of some fellowship together. And I'll tell you more about that as we get closer. But you need to mark Sunday night the 19th and Wednesday night the 22nd on your calendar, both at 6:30 p.m. Both are going to be awesome. I've had sneak peeks into both of them, and I'm looking forward to those two nights of worship together. And then last thing, and let me switch gears for just a second. This will take a minute. If you're visiting with us, I'll let you into how we do stuff for just a moment, and or you can tune this part out. Either way, Wednesday night, the 15th, that's not this Wednesday, but the next, we're going to be having a what we call a members meeting. This will be a time where the church body, our members, come together here. The entire 60 minutes, the entire hour will be devoted to us presenting and answering questions that deal with the finances of the church. So our fiscal year is January 1 to December 31. So we need to put in place a 2022 budget, which is our intentions of how we intend to spend our money in 2022. That plan, that proposed budget, is on the desk back here when you leave this morning. You need to grab one. You need to look that over. It's also it's presented on paper in a contrast to the 2021 budget, which we were finishing up. There's the 2022. You can look that over. You've got about, 10 days? It's exactly 10 days from now to think through questions and then come that night intending to ask your questions and have your questions answered. There'll be some other information, financial information will be presented that night. We do this because 2 weeks from today, I know I'm throwing a ton of dates at you. I've already asked for forgiveness once. 2 weeks from today, we'll actually approve that 2022 budget following the service. You have chance, opportunity to ask your questions on Wednesday night so that on Sunday, it's a very quick approval of that proposed budget so that your Methodist friends do not beat you to the Mexican place. Okay? Like I'm doing, this is for you. So we schedule the Wednesday night Q&A so that you can get to lunch quickly on Sunday. So on the 19th. So a lot going on. Grab that budget as you leave. And if you have any questions about it. Lastly, let me say this on that budget. I want to encourage you to do one thing. Take that. I want you to look at the mathematics, calculations, figures, whatever. Make your heart content with all of that stuff. But more importantly than that, I want you to take those numbers and make them an item of prayer. That proposed budget, listen, this is not we worship on Sunday mornings, and then we have to do business as well. Like, why can't that be part of worship? Why can't our hearts together say, we trust that this is what God, we've prayed, you prayerfully selected a finance committee, you prayerfully put these people on there. They have prayerfully put this thing together. They've prayerfully consulted other committees for numbers, et cetera. You get how all that works. And this is the conclusion of it. We'll happily engage and discuss and answer whatever questions are necessary. But at the end of the day, we trust the Spirit of Almighty God. And when we put numbers on paper, we've got to trust God with that. And so I'm going to ask you to pray. Put it in where if you have a prayer journal, if you open... pray with your Bible open, stick it in there, and when you pull that out on every morning and you pray for the next 14 days until the 19th when we vote to approve that, you pray through that and ask God if this is where God is taking our congregation, okay? Let's do that. Let me finally kill the lights for just one quick second. I want you to turn your attention for 30 seconds to the screen, and then our praise team will, you can stand afterwards, and our praise team will take us out in song, I think. All right, go.
I'm not changing.
Well, it's good to see you too, Luther.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's great to be back. I'm back, baby.
Yeah, we're
season
back.
Two.
Season two of Table Talk with Luther.
That's right.
Back.
Yep.
High five.
I said,
Thank y'all for worshiping with us today. Enjoy your Sunday.